age of five. I had some in my pocket. Keep a lot of folks alive.
Chicago's South Side, home of Chess Records, an independent label founded in 1950 by brothers Phil and Leonard Chess. The Chesses recorded what came to be known as Chicago Blues. Mississippi Delta bluesmen like Muddy Waters, James Cotton, and Howlin' Wolf, who now used electric guitars and amplified harmonicas to be heard over the din in big city nightclubs.
We noticed that the electric sound, the echo, all those kind of gimmicks really were catching on, something new. So Chess, then we started looking for new and different things. You know, that's what, you know, we saw that the original and the fresh stuff, the fresh sound, was what sold records.
Mid-50s, the Chesses operated out of a storefront studio on Cottage Grove Avenue in a neighborhood known as Little Mississippi. In March 1955, the Chesses heard a different sound. Electric guitar played in a new way by an eccentric black man who called himself Bo Diddley. He was born Ellis McDaniel in Macomb, Mississippi in 1928. By the mid-30s, his family had moved to Chicago, and until he acquired his first guitar, young Bo Diddley studied violin at the Ebenezer Missionary Baptist Church on Chicago's South Side. Bo Diddley brought his percussive sound to an audience of millions in November 1955 on the country's top-rated variety program, The Ed Sullivan Show. As primetime television was gradually beginning to acknowledge the growing popularity of black music, his rhythms would soon become rock and roll mainstays, propelling hits by everyone from Buddy Holly and Johnny Otis in the late 50s to punk and heavy metal bands of a more recent decade.
Why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline. Can't you be true? You just started back doing the things you used to do.
Style was different. The backbeat was different. It was the birth of the beat.
In fact, the beat wasn't heavy enough. My brother went out in the studio and got a phone book and took a drum stick and was banging it. He wasn't even keeping time, but he was just banging it just to get the beat heavier.
Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline.
In the summer of 1955, Maybelline reached number 5 on the pop charts, the first top 10 hit for Chess Records. Zeroed in on the exploding white teenage market, writing songs about adolescent concerns and desires. Roll Over Beethoven, School Day, Rock and Roll Music, Sweet Little 16 and Johnny B. Goode became anthems for a generation. And young kids from Bruce Springsteen to John Lennon dreamed of playing the guitar like Chuck Berry.
One for the money, two for the show. Three to get ready, now go, can't go, don't you step on my blue suede shoes. You can do anything, lay off of my blue suede shoes.
Presley's version of Blue Suede Shoes kicked off his first television appearance. RCA and his new manager, Colonel Tom Parker, were launching Presley nationally. By the end of 1956, he would have 2 number one albums, a hit movie, and a dozen network television appearances. He was becoming the biggest attraction on television. But America's most prestigious host, Ed Sullivan, maintained he would never present such vulgar entertainment. But by the fall of 1956, Elvis was just too big for Sullivan to ignore. Over the 10 months Presley had been away from Sam Phillips, his music had become tamer, sweetened with background singers, his delivery more contained. RCA, Colonel Parker, and Presley himself wanted to reach a wider, more mainstream audience. He would never again record with the raw vitality of his early Sun sessions. But back in Memphis, Sam Phillips had discovered another explosive young talent. Jerry Lee Lewis was born midway between Memphis and New Orleans in Faraday, Louisiana in 1935. His musical education began in the mid-40s at a black honky-tonk called Haney's Big House. Sam Phillips signed the 21-year-old Lewis to Sun Records. Then sometime in 1956, in a club called the Wagon Wheel, Lewis heard the song that would ignite his career. The small, adventurous labels and the disc jockeys who played their records had opened doors to new sounds and new attitudes. But an unlikely series of events nearly silenced rock and roll as the 50s drew to a close. Little Richard traded the devil's music for religion in January 1958. 2 months later, Elvis Presley entered the army.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much love drives a man insane. You broke my will.
Jerry Lee Lewis was blacklisted after his marriage to his 13-year-old cousin was revealed. Chuck Berry was arrested for transporting a teenage girl across state lines in 1959. And promising new talents were struck down in fatal accidents. Buddy Holly, Ritchie Valens, the Big Bopper, and Eddie Cochran.
Why I feel blue without Peggy.
Turn me loose, turn me loose, I say. Yeah,
and as major record labels went after the teen market, they saturated record stores and airwaves with non-threatening, squeaky clean teen idols. And many radio pioneers came under fire for accepting money from record companies, even though the practice was common and perfectly legal. Alan Freed's turbulent career was cut short by the so-called payola scandal. He died at the age of 42.
Well, I heard the news, that good to rock and tonight. Well, I heard the news, that good to rock and tonight.
By 1960, the first wave of rock and roll's free-spirited renegades had subsided. But the genie was out of the bottle.